In this video, we're going to compute the volume enclosed between the region pictured here in the xy plane and the surface z equals 3x, which is not pictured. To set up this computation, let's first identify the region that we're looking at in the xy plane. This green shaded area is a circle centered at 5, 0 with a radius of 5. So the equation of this circle is x minus 5 squared plus y squared equals 25. So the first thing we have to do is decide what kind of coordinate system we would like to describe this region with. I propose that we use polar coordinates. So what I'm going to take you through is a demonstration of how to find the angular and radial bounds for what will become a double integral computation. If you're looking at this and you want to use xy Cartesian coordinates and set up double integrals of the form something dx dy or dy dx, I will show you what that looks like at the very end of this video. What I'm going to do is take this ray that I've just placed on top of the negative y-axis, and I'm going to imagine rotating it counterclockwise through this region. So let's pause here for a moment. To give you a preview of the future bounds, we are looking at what angles we rotate through in order to cover this region. So we started on the negative y-axis, and we're going to rotate counterclockwise. So the rotation that we perform will give us our bounds on theta. And then for the radial coordinate, we want to imagine traveling outward from the origin to the edge of the region as we rotate. So at this moment where we've paused in the fourth quadrant, our radial coordinate is bounded below by 0. That places us on the origin. And then r increases outwards until we are hitting the edge of the circle. Let's keep going. I'm just going to pause here. Thinking in terms of the rotation, we've gone from the negative y-axis to the positive x-axis. And then our radial coordinate is going from the origin out all the way to 10. This is actually the largest that this radial coordinate will ever be, but that doesn't mean that 10 is the appropriate upper bound for the radial coordinate when we describe this region. And that is because 10 is not a uniform bound across our rotation. So if I keep going at this point in the first quadrant, the radial coordinate is going from 0 out to the edge of the circle, and the length of this segment is less than 10. And then to finish rotating around our region, we end up on the positive x-axis. So let's summarize. We've stopped our rotation at what I would like to call theta equals pi over 2. Where did we begin it? Down here on the negative y-axis. You might want to call that 3 pi over 2, but we need to make our domain a nice continuous description. So the rotation that we did went from negative pi over 2 on the negative y-axis through 0 when we touched the x-axis and then up to pi over 2. We wouldn't want to say 3 pi over 2 up to 2 pi, drop down to 0, and then continue on to pi over 2. So you want it to be one nice unbroken motion. If you are wondering if we really should make our rotation go from the negative y-axis to the positive y-axis, notice that the domain of integration is really tangent to these axes. So if I try to rotate inwards at all, as soon as I do, I'm inside the region. So the bounds on the angular coordinate really do go from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, from the lower point of tangency to the upper point of tangency. Let's summarize what we have so far. For the bounds on this region, we know that the radial coordinate is bounded below by 0, placing us at the origin throughout our rotation, and then it's bounded above by whenever it hits the circle. So that bound is going to come from the equation of the circle converted into polar coordinates. And then theta's bounds are going from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. It remains to describe the upper bound for the radial coordinate. Notice it's not constant because, as we noticed, the length of the segment from the origin out to the circle varied as we rotated. That means this upper bound is going to be a function of theta. To figure it out, let's revisit the equation of the circle in Cartesian coordinates. So as we said before, the circle with center 5, 0 and radius 5 has the equation x minus 5 squared plus y squared equals 25. I'm going to expand that in Cartesian coordinates. So if I expand that first term, we get x squared minus 10x plus 25 plus y squared equals 25. Cancel out the 25s and move the 10x to the other side, and we get x squared plus y squared equals 10x. Now seems like a good moment to convert to polar coordinates. For polar coordinates centered at the origin, x squared plus y squared is r squared, and then x is r cosine theta. We're trying to solve for r here, so either r equals 0, which is actually just the origin, or r equals 10 cosine theta. That 10 cosine theta is what we're looking for. Okay, now we have the bounds for our double integral. Let's go ahead and set it up. Because r is being described as trapped between 0 and a function of theta, it must be the inside integral. And then theta's bounds are constant, so we'll put that on the outside. So the double integral that we need in order to compute the volume trapped between this disk in the xy plane and the graph of the surface, z equals 3x, is computed by taking the double integral from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, and from 0 to 10 cosine of theta, of the integrand 3x converted into polar coordinates. So that's going to be 3r cosine theta, and then we pick up an extra factor of r from the conversion into polar, dr d theta. We need to integrate with respect to r, and we actually have 3r squared, so the antiderivative of that is r cubed. So now we have the integral from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, cosine of theta times r cubed, where we need to plug in the top and bottom bounds. The bottom bound is just 0, but when we plug in the top bound, we'll have 10 cubed, that's 1,000, times the integral from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2 of cosine times cosine cubed. So that's going to be cosine to the fourth power, and then we need to integrate this with respect to theta. The first thing I'm going to notice is that my integrand is even symmetric, because we're taking a quantity and raising it to an even power. Therefore, the integral from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2 could be computed by doing twice the integral from 0 to pi over 2, so that's one change I'll make. And I just like to look for that kind of thing because I always like to have 0 as one of my bounds of integration whenever it's possible. And now we need to use techniques of trigonometric integration, so I'm going to take cosine to the fourth and write that as cosine squared squared. And then to handle that cosine squared on the inside, let's use power reducing. So cosine theta, that quantity squared, is 1/2 plus cosine of 2 theta divided by 2. I'm going to take that 1/2 that they have in common, square it, and pull it out front, giving us 2,000 over 4 times the integral from 0 to pi over 2. And then if I expand what remains in the integrand, that's 1 plus cosine 2 theta, if I square that, we get 1 plus 2 cosine 2 theta plus cosine squared 2 theta, which we will again do power reduction on. So now we have 500 times the integral from 0 to pi over 2 of 1 plus 2 cosine 2 theta plus 1/2 plus cosine 4 theta over 2 d theta. This integral is actually very easy to do at this point. If you recognize that cosine 2 theta and cosine 4 theta, each of these functions encloses the same amount of positive and negative area between 0 and pi over 2. So if we do the definite integral of either of those cosine terms from 0 to pi over 2, it's going to be 0. So we can just cross those out. Now we're left with integrating 3/2 from 0 to pi over 2. So that's just integrating a constant. So we have 500 times 3/2 times pi over 2 minus 0, or in other words, 375 pi. Okay, the heart of this problem was setting up the bounds for the domain of integration, but I hope you enjoyed seeing the trigonometric integration as well. We've answered the question that we set out to address. So now we have the volume enclosed between this region and the graph of z equals 3x. But I want to show you why polar coordinates was my preference here. So let me set up two other integrals that compute the same value. The first will be dy dx, and the second will be dx dy. You might call those type 1 and type 2 integrals. So for the computation on the left, where I want to set up an integral in the order dy dx, I want to view this region as going from one function of the form y equals f of x to another. In order to get those functions, I'm going to go back to the equation that we saw earlier, x squared plus y squared equals 10x. This will give us a quick way to find the equations of the lower curve and the upper curve, giving us the lower bound for y and the upper bound for y. Okay, so now we can say that that lower curve is, you know, it's a lower semicircle. It has the form y equals negative square root of 10x minus x squared. Whereas the upper semicircle has the form y equals square root of 10x minus x squared. And then the bounds on x as the outer integral must be constant, so we look to the left and right, and we can see that x goes from 0 to 10. So if you wanted to compute this volume using Cartesian coordinates, and you wanted to set up an integral of the form dy dx, this is what it would look like. You have the double integral as x goes from 0 to 10, and y goes from that lower semicircle to the upper semicircle, the integrand 3x dy dx. The issue here is that you need to anti-differentiate first with respect to y, and when you do, you'll end up with twice the square root of 10x minus x squared times the 3x. So that gives us the integral from 0 to 10 of 6x times the square root of 10x minus x squared. This is actually kind of tricky to integrate. So this is a more challenging computation than what we did a moment ago. Keep in mind that the final answer was 375 pi, so you're going to end up bringing in some kind of polar conversion. Now let's stick with Cartesian coordinates, but I want to describe this region for an integral set up in the form dx dy, meaning I want to view the x variable as going from one function of y on the left to another function of y on the right. In order to find these bounds, I'm going to take the equation we had, x minus 5 squared plus y squared equals 25, move the y squared over, and then take the square root of both sides. This is a quick way to solve for x. So that the curve on the left semicircle, is x equals 5 minus the square root of 25 minus y squared, whereas the semicircle on the right is x equals 5 plus the square root of 25 minus y squared. Those will be the interior bounds for our double integral, and then the exterior bounds will be just for y. That's going to go from the smallest value of y to the largest, or in other words, from negative 5 to 5. Okay, so here's what that double integral looks like. It's actually a bit better than the one on the left, although you might not initially recognize it as such. But what happens is after one round of anti-differentiation with respect to x and plugging in the bounds, you're left with 30 times the integral from negative 5 to 5 of the square root of 25 minus y squared dy. If you do not recognize geometrically what that is computing, you could solve this with trig substitution. So again, you would end up needing to bring in trigonometric coordinates, which shouldn't surprise you since the final answer had pi in it. On the other hand, if you think about what a single integral computes, it's area between the x-axis and the graph of the integrand. The square root of 25 minus y squared is the upper semicircle of radius 5. So I can say this is 30 times half the area of a circle whose radius is 5, and that is indeed 375 pi. Okay, I hope you enjoyed looking at this double integral computation with me and seeing how to set up the bounds for the polar computation. That was the most important goal here. I hope I convinced you that that's the best way to solve this problem. Thank you for your attention.